Anthony is a professor at the University of Massachusetts in Amherst. She got her PhD at Harvard University and has published a number of journal articles and book chapters in epistemology, the philosophy of language, the philosophy of mind, and feminist theory. In these areas, she's edited books on Chomsky and feminist epistemology and metaphysics. And her work can be, an important part of her work is its engagement with psychological research about how we as limited human creatures process, represent, and access information. And she thinks about the epistemic and social implications of those things. She has shared her work and insights not only across the international community through invited invitations such as ours, but also at the New York Times Opinionator blog, which is a really terrific post there. I highly recommend them. So without further ado, please help me welcome the veteran.
Thanks, Harold. Thanks so much to everyone involved in this conference for putting it together and for inviting me. I've learned an enormous amount already, but I think that you've learned enough from what we're talking about. I do feel like many of the things that I'm going to try to argue for have been argued for very effectively in the morning, and the things that I'm going to add are probably false, so I don't know. But I'm going to try to soldier through. So Time magazine on March 23rd, 2017 had a big headline front page or cover that said, "Is Truth Dead?" I don't know how many of you remember the "Is God Dead?" Time magazine cover, but apparently it was a very self-conscious allusion back to that sort of uncanny, earth-shaking sort of question. So I don't think the truth is dead at all. I don't think people have stopped caring about the truth. Certainly in mundane contexts, they care a lot about the truth. So if you buy a car and you're supposed to get 45 miles per gallon and I have only a certain amount of emissions, and that turns out not to be the case, people care. If you go to the airport and it says that your flight is leaving from the B13 and it's not, you care. So when truth matters, right, we care about truth. So the question then is, why do we elect people who don't seem to care what the truth is? And I think that the answer to this question is partly political and partly epistemological. So let me start with the epistemological issues. And I should say, I have no slides because I have no data. I'm going to be making philosophical, theoretical points that I hope are backed up by the data, but I trust that someone will set me straight if that's not the case. So the first thing I want to call attention to is just the difficulty of finding the truth on many matters of current concerns. I'm a highly educated person with lots of degrees. I've gone to a lot of colleges and gotten some degrees, with lots of control over my daily schedule, and yet I find it extremely difficult to gain more than a passing understanding of many important issues of our time. I certainly cannot personally confirm or disconfirm many of the propositions I believe to be true, including some that form the basis of my political allegiances. These include the following, for example. I believe that there is human-caused climate change going on. If a climate change denier were to argue with me and I had to produce the data, I would be in bad shape. I believe that public jobs programs will help the economy more than tax reductions for the wealthy. And here it's entirely Paul Krugman's fault. If he's wrong, then I'm helpless. And my belief in general that the free market, the so-called free market, produces neither efficacy nor efficiency in the delivery of healthcare. So just a few things that I believe. And why do I believe them? Well, because I trust the experts who research them and the news agencies who report them. But that just pushes the question back. Why these experts? Why these reporters? Why do I trust the people that I trust? Now here it's tempting to say, as I have heard people in my milieu say, that we trust the particular experts we trust because they are the ones who are objective. Okay, but what does this objectivity consist? Now, I think that one thing people might have in mind is that the trustworthy experts have the following characteristics. First of all, they consider all the facts. They're not selective. Secondly, they base their conclusions on the facts and not on their own opinions or feelings. Third, they consider both sides of a controversy and respond rationally to objections or problems. Taken together, these tenets constitute an epistemological ideal that I like to call dragnet objectivity. Older members of the audience will catch my allusion here to a once popular television police procedural featuring two LA cops. One of them, Sergeant Bill Friday, was a no-nonsense guy. He eschewed premature theorizing. If any of his interviewees ventured to offer an opinion about the circumstances of the crime or the identity of the criminal, Friday would cut them off curtly with his signature phrase, say it with me, just the facts, ma'am. Oh, that didn't work. Okay. Only after all the evidence was in and only after carefully considering it would Friday reach a conclusion about the crime. Now, no sensible person would expect ordinary mortals to live up to the sterling example set by Sergeant Friday. But I do think that a great many sensible people, including me in weak moments, believe that we ought to try. That is, we believe that the more closely we can emulate Sergeant Friday's method, the better our researches will be. Dragnet objectivity represents then an epistemological ideal. This ideal gives rise to the corollary belief that when epistemic success, when it does occur, is explained by knowers adherence to the method of Sergeant Friday. So the more dragnet objective science is, the more successful it will be. Look how successful it is, that vindicates the norms of dragnet epistemology. So it's precisely because science has been so spectacularly successful, and I don't have a substantive measure to add, but you can think about the eradication of smallpox or the lunar landing or whatever your favorite example might be. Since it's been so spectacularly successful, there's been a lot of confirmation of the validity of the dragnet objective ideal. We think science has been successful precisely because its methods so closely match Sergeant Friday's. And then we're inclined to explain failures in science or setbacks in science in terms of departure from the ideal of objectivity. So some scientist was too much after fame, or some person couldn't get publications unless he fudged the data or something like that. Okay, if you look at any grade school science textbook, and I haven't surveyed them all, but if you do an internet search or you go to your local middle school, I promise you, you'll find this. You'll find an explanation of something called the scientific method that's virtually identical to the dragnet procedure that I outlined above. So first you form a hypothesis, then you generate a prediction, then you get the data. If the data don't support your hypothesis, you give up the hypothesis and you start over again. Dragnet objectivity, however, I'm going to argue, is not a suitable ideal for human inquiry. It is, first of all, difficult to impossible for human beings to implement, successful scientists and incisive reporters notwithstanding. But more importantly, it would be a disaster for human inquiry if we were to implement it. That's the first thing I'm going to try to persuade you of. According to this conception of objectivity, individuals charged with finding or promulgating the truth must divest themselves of background beliefs and stick to just the facts. Since it's impossible for human knowers to follow that advice, the charge of bias can be credibly leveled at almost anyone, including the scientists and reporters who compose the set of experts on whom most of us are forced to rely. Anyone with a megaphone or an internet connection can point to and credibly label as biases premises that their opponent does and must take for granted. This is the route through which an organization like Fox News is able to represent itself as fair and balanced. It's also the route through which white power and other hate groups can claim to be redressing discrimination. Right? So next to the slogan Black Lives Matter, we have the slogan All Lives Matter. Right? We're not biased, we're not only concerned with black people. Now, I want to talk about a specific challenge that I think is very important right now, and it goes to the question I asked Kate about anti-Zionism. I am a supporter of Jewish Voice for Peace. I honor the boycott, divestments, and sanctions movement. And I am convinced that there is a significant threat to free speech being mounted by people who want to quash that discussion. So there's a significant threat to free speech coming from American Zionists who use the language of hate speech, and this is a kind of virtue signaling that's very self-conscious, in order to silence critics of the Israeli occupation of Palestine. There's currently a bill before the U.S. House and Senate called the Israel Anti-Boycott Act, and this act would make it a felony for U.S. citizens to support boycotts of Israel and Israeli settlements, punishable by at least a $250,000 fine, with a maximum penalty of a fine of $1 million and 20 years in prison. So far, 46 senators, including Maria Campwell from the state of Washington, and 31 Republican senators and 15 Democrats, and 234 Congress members from both sides of the aisle have supported the legislation. This bill was probably written by the American Israeli, the American Israel Public Affairs Committee, known as AIPAC, and AIPAC has quite explicitly and openly made the passage of this bill one of the group's top lobbying priorities for the year. My husband, who is Jewish, is also very active in this movement, and he's one of the people that has been banned from entering the state of Israel because of his support for BDS and his membership in Jewish Voice for Peace. And I bring this up because it's a very good example of how a sense of what's extreme can actually stigmatize and marginalize an opinion that should be taken seriously. And this is not to challenge Kate's characterization of conspiracy theorists and so forth, but it is to point to the difficulty of coming up with formal criteria that distinguish the theorists who you want to say are out of touch with reality and people who generally are, who genuinely are marginalized because they are saying something that people are not used to hearing. And I'd be happy to talk about the substance of that later. There's a great deal of AIPAC is using the charge of hate speech just because of its current political potency. Okay, but if we don't adopt the standard of dragnet objectivity, then what? Well, this is the good question. The central epistemological problem that human beings have to solve is a problem that the American philosopher Lord Vitterman and Quine labeled the underdetermination of theory by evidence. The problem is that, first of all, we always have only a finite amount of evidence, and secondly, for any finite amount of evidence, there's an infinite number of hypotheses that are logically consistent with that evidence. This means that there's no such thing, even for particular individual issues, as all the facts. It also means that the facts alone cannot determine any particular hypothesis to be better than a host of its competitors. Some other factor has to come into the picture, if only to cut down the set of alternatives to some manageable number. This other factor, surprisingly, is bias. And I want to use the word bias in its neutral sense, which means an inclination. So I want to say there's good bias and there's bad bias, and I want to try to say a little bit about how what constitutes the difference. It turns out that the fundamental explanation for our human ability to know is that we come to every epistemic challenge pre-equipped with concepts and background beliefs that condition every step of the process of inquiry. Where we look for evidence, how we interpret evidence, which alternative hypotheses we consider, and how we respond to challenges. The underdetermination problem is present both at the level of the individual knower and at the level of societies of knowers, and bias is present at both levels. At the level of the individual, native biases enable us to learn important things that we would not otherwise be able to learn. The most dramatic and well-understood example is language acquisition. Human children typically manage within 3 or 4 years to acquire a very complicated system of symbolic communication without explicit instruction or correction. It turns out adults try to correct children, but first of all, they correct for things that are rude or false, not for things that are grammatical or ungrammatical. And there's tons and tons of evidence that when parents or other adults try to correct children for grammar, the children just ignore them. It just does, has no effect on the distribution of their speech. In contrast, highly intelligent non-human animals, like gorillas and chimpanzees, can master vocabulary, but virtually no syntax, even after years of assiduous instruction. Chomsky offered an explanation for this amazing feat in terms of bias. Human beings, he argued, are born with an innate cognitive structure that is primed to build a grammar on the basis of minimal exposure to human speech. More generally, it's clear that almost all animals operate with what Quine called an innate similarity space, a structure of native bias about what kinds of similarities among the objects in their experience are and are not important for understanding general features of the world. In some cases, these biases selectively link certain kinds of stimuli with certain kinds of behavior. Pigeons, for example, can be trained to peck at a visual stimulus, like a colored spot on the ground, and can be trained to take flight in response to a particular sound, like a bell. But they cannot be trained to peck in response to a bell, or to fly in response to a red spot. For many animals, innate knowledge involves more than parameters of stimulus generalization. Some animals, like birds and insects, have very complex innate mechanisms or procedures that guide them in noticing and using certain kinds of information. For example, indigo buntings. Where's Carl? Where's my birder? Indigo buntings, right? Indigo buntings, am I right? Indigo buntings, who migrate up to 1,200 miles, are primed to attend to the fixed point in the rotating night sky, the North Star, and then to use that fixed point to guide their migration due south. Similarly, human children are primed to attend to speech sounds. They show a preference for speech over other sorts of sounds at the earliest age at which contemporary methodology allows them to be tested. Interestingly, though, children do not need auditory stimuli in order to acquire language. We know that children can acquire language through visual stimuli, through signing, and also through tactile stimuli. So we don't know about, maybe there's a way of acquiring language from taste and smell, but we don't know about that yet. Okay, biases in these cases play a constructive role in the building of human knowledge. But there's a downside. The same cognitive biases that enable us to quickly sort other animals into groups so that we can form useful generalizations about their characteristics and their behavior can also work to enable pernicious social biases. The philosopher and cognitive scientist Sarah Jane Leslie, in an article called The Original Sin of Cognition, offers this sort of explanation for the development of certain kinds of social prejudice. She argues, first of all, that we human beings are prone to making generalizations on the basis of just a few examples in cases where the salient property is striking or dangerous. These are two terms that she uses to characterize this dimension. So she points out, well, let's see, how many of you believe that ticks carry Lyme disease? Raise your hands. Ticks carry Lyme disease. How many of you think that Canadians are right-handed? What percentage of Canadians are right-handed? Most of them. What percentage of ticks carry Lyme disease? Virtually none, right? And yet we all accept the generic, like, thank you. Carrying a disease, right, is a very dangerous property. And so it's the kind of property that we are primed to make generalizations about. The utility of this cognitive mechanism is obvious, and it enables us, or at least enough of us, to avoid contracting Lyme disease. But then, Leslie goes on to explain, if this cognitive mechanism is set into motion, in environments that are shaped by social injustice, it can lead to such pernicious judgments as, black people are criminals, said by a white person, or Muslims are terrorists, said by an American Christian. The upshot I want to argue is that social prejudices are not necessarily the result of stupidity or sloppy reasoning. They may be the result of the normal, generally useful cognitive mechanisms being deployed in a bad environment, by that I mean epistemically unpropitious environment. Now, another important fact, beliefs acquired through the operation of this cognitive generalization mechanism are pretty resistant to counterexamples. So I show you a tick, I say, what do you mean ticks carry Lyme disease? This tick doesn't. Will have virtually no effect on your generic belief that ticks carry Lyme disease. Once I form the generic belief, I won't give it up just because I learned there are some ticks that aren't carriers. Confronted with a counterexample, I'll say something like, well, in general, ticks carry Lyme disease. So authors of language and psycholinguists have been very interested in these kinds of generalizations that have these properties. Leslie explains this pattern in terms of a folk theory of essences. If we have formed a generic belief about ticks, we have also probably adopted the view, implicitly, that there's some property that all and only ticks have, and in virtue of which ticks are ticks, and also that this property is one that at least disposes ticks to carry the disease, even if they don't currently carry it. So the folk theory would be something like, ticks are the kinds of things that will carry Lyme disease. I think this hypothesis about the way generic generalizations are made and their behavior explains the persistence of certain kinds of racist and sexist beliefs even in the face of myriad counterexamples. So if you think that girls can't do math, and you see a girl who's getting a higher grade than you are in her math class, it's easy to write that off because, well, she's an exception. When you hear somebody making that kind of response to a counterexample to a claim that they've articulated, well, that's just an exception. There's probably a generic generalization in the background. Leslie's analysis, this folk metaphysics, where kinds have essences, and these essences can have be the ground of dispositions to do or be a certain way, follows what developmental psychologists like Marjorie Rhodes and Susan Gelman have posited. And it's consonant with what many critical race theorists believe to be the folk metaphysics of race, or at least that races are. Anthony Appiah, for example, defines racism in terms of a background metaphysical view he calls racialism, the view that races are natural kinds with distinctive essences. Racialism turns into racism when some morally problematic trait is taken to be part of the essence of that race. A similar process may underlie and facilitate the development of pernicious biases about social groups. To the extent that we view people from other cultures or backgrounds from our own as forming a kind different from our own, we prepare ourselves to construct durable, dangerous property generic beliefs about them. Fortunately, this process of othering, as it's sometimes called, can be undone or even prevented, an especially effective remedy. There are going to be like four hopeful sentences in my talk this morning. An especially effective remedy for this, it turns out, is entering into sustained cooperative joint activity with those one experiences as other. The kind of biases that I've been discussing operate subconsciously, although, as I've noted, they can feed into conscious prejudice as well. We don't usually realize that you're filtering evidence or failing to consider alternative hypotheses in the cases I've described above. But what happens when we consciously inquire? When we explicitly consider our evidence and weigh alternatives? To consider that question, let's switch to our main topic, how to responsibly form judgments about complicated matters. Start with science. Work beginning in the 1960s by Thomas Kuhn and other historians of science, as well as naturalistic philosophers, a philosopher is naturalistic if he or she thinks that philosophical inquiry should be continuous with and informed by empirical research. Naturalistic philosophers like Quine and Hilary Putnam argue that successful science depends on the existence of a form of social organization that Kuhn called a paradigm. A paradigm involves, most importantly, a set of background assumptions. These include a consensus about central tenets, an agreed upon methodology, and a common understanding as to what questions need investigating. So psychology at the moment is a science without a paradigm, and that accounts for some of the pointless crosstalk that you get in this field. Philosophy does not have a paradigm either, or at least it has too many. Now the central tenets, the things that, as a matter of sociological fact, are taken as more or less the main things, the main doctrines. In practical terms, these are held to be unrevisable. there will be no experimental findings that challenge these tenets because the tenets themselves structured the experiments. That is, the researcher's confidence that a certain experiment will yield useful information depends upon taking the background tenets to be true. If, however, enough anomalous observational results accumulate, and if some theorist comes up with an alternative theoretical framework, and that is a crucial if, there may be what Kuhn called a paradigm shift, a wholesale migration for the scientific community from one organizing theoretical picture to another. The shift from Newtonian to relativistic physics is one example of a paradigm shift, and the shift from Linnaean to evolutionary biology was another. And I was very intrigued to hear Kevin say that diversity of cognitive method is a plus in science. If that's so, it might be that what Kuhn has been arguing for is not correct or needs these qualifications, so I'm eager to follow up on that. In short, science as we find it does not follow the scientific method. Commitment to background theory is a precondition for crafting useful experimental programs, and this is very important. Consideration of theories incompatible with the core tenets is ruled out. Kuhn makes clear that, for example, progress in biology, dependent as it currently is on the evolutionary paradigm, would be seriously impeded if scientists had to stop and consider the hypotheses advanced by creationists. They're justified, Kuhn argues, in dismissing such hypotheses from the start. It is precisely because biologists ignore such fundamental challenges that they have been able to make the progress they have, or so Kuhn claims. Now, in science, so in life in general, if we want to understand our complex world, we cannot behave like Sergeant Friday. We cannot garner all the pertinent facts. There's an unlimited number of those, and so we have to be selective. Not only that, we can't even get facts in quite the sense that Dragnet epistemology assumes. As I said earlier, I would have only the vaguest clue what experimental evidence there is for human-caused climate change. I know what the experts I rely on say is the evidence, but I haven't read the original papers by the original researchers. And if I tried to do my own research, this is one problem of doing your own research, I wouldn't understand them. In this matter, as in many, many others, I rely on testimony. So, you know, I remember reading the columnist for Nation, Alexander Kober, who's a bit of a climate change denier. I don't know if anybody knows this. And he cited this data that seemed very, it seemed like, that's really a problem for people who think there's climate change, which had to do with non-correlations between rises in temperature and the huge period of industrialization, where the amount of carbon being pumped into the atmosphere grew enormously at a very high rate. I don't know how to go about. I mean, it looks like it's a problem for climate change from my perspective, but I'm not a climate change scientist. So I trust that the people that are, have something to say back to them. Okay, now here again, in our reliance on testimony, we have a generally useful cognitive habit, which is believing what people tell us, that works pretty well in a certain range of circumstances. Most of us, I expect, have asked a stranger for directions, followed them, and then arrived at our destination. Most of us believe with a native credulity, and there's a lot of evidence that we are very credulous creatures. It takes a lot before we'll challenge what somebody else says. Most of us believe much of what our parents told us, at least initially. It's hard to imagine a serious measure of this, but I venture to say that if we take into account mundane information like that stove is hot, parental testimony is more often true than not. As I said, I don't know if you get a serious measure. But as we become more epistemically ambitious, we have to make explicit choices, who to talk to and what to listen to. What we will rely on as we make these choices is going to be guided, for better or for worse, by our background theories. Once more, the facts alone cannot guide us. It's impossible to assess the significance of facts, that is, the significance of truths per se, without background theories. The reason is that empirical reasoning, that is, reasoning that depends on propositions that are not self-evident, reasons for which we need evidence, and conclusion propositions where the evidential support, is not deductively valid, not a demonstration like in American logic. Reasoning of this sort is called non-monotonic. What it is for reasoning to be non-monotonic is this. adding a new truth to the truths you already have can reverse the valence of your conclusion and change everything. Consider, Breitbart News reported that 402,000 crimes were committed by migrants in Germany in 2015. Now, this figure suggests that the alt-right opponents of liberal immigration policies are right to think that such policies threaten domestic security. But now add the consideration that this figure includes a crime labeled crossing the border as an asylum seeker. Taking out those crimes leaves Germany's crime rate roughly the same as in other years. Now, when I first heard the Breitbart report, I heard this on an episode of This American Life, that maybe some of you have heard, which is really very, very important for my purposes because it tells a story of a man in Alaska who was trying to get the facts about whether immigration would lead to a rise in crime or not. And he didn't follow politics, he had no background theories about stuff, and his journey was very interesting to me. So what was surprising to me was hearing that the Breitbart claim was corroborated by Damian McGinnis, a BBC correspondent who had been reporting from Berlin for 14 years. The BBC is one of my trusted sources. But then I was counter-surprised to hear that, as I tacitly hoped to be the case, there was context that changed the significance of the Breitbart factoid. Breitbart had not reported the context. But a defender of dragon objectivity should not take comfort in this incident. It looks like we've got a fact, we've got another fact, and everything's right again. My background distrust of Breitbart and my near reflexive trust of the BBC and of This American Life, from Public Radio International, I stay with it, are not based on my own careful comparison of the respective reliabilities of these news sources. How would I assess reliability anyway? I have to use the very sources I'm evaluating to find out what the facts are and check and see if the sources are reporting them correctly. My pattern of attitudes has much more to do with the coherence of the products of these sources with my background theory of the world. And the project of justifying one's background theory of the world to someone with a different background theory, as was remarked earlier, is huge. Spin is something that one's opponents do. Contextualizing is what is practiced by me and my fellow counselors. This is why I cringe when I hear friends bemoan the stupidity or the ignorance of the masses. I do not believe that everyone who relies on Fox News is intellectually challenged, nor do I believe that all of my fellow progressives are paradigms of epistemic responsibility. We cannot separate reliable news sources from unreliable ones on the basis of formal criteria. People who get their news from Fox do, it's true, operate within an echo chamber, but it turns out so do I. A multitude of studies indicate that people in general rely on news sources that reflect their own political perspectives, a trend that's been exacerbated by the internet and the rise of social media. So, which blogs do you read? I read Feminist Philosopher, I read Daily News, I read The Intercept, and I'm not clicking on clickbait about celebrity fashion. But those are these are all progressive sources. You're not gonna be a counterweight to the things that I'm disposed to believe anyway. Numerous studies also show that breaking out of one's bubble is unlikely to make any difference. Mere exposure to disconfirming evidence has been shown in a number of domains to increase people's confidence in their original opinions. So studies present people with fake studies that argue for a conclusion the person doesn't believe, and the result is that the subjects express more confidence in the belief that they had than they had before they were challenged. What is to be done? To some extent, my advice here is negative. We must not exhort people to check the facts. I check my facts at PolitiFact. We cannot exhort them to be more critical or to find out what the other side has to say. Individualistic strategies like this are not going to work, at least not in a widespread or general way. As is true for scientists, a citizen aiming to be well-informed will do less well if he or she tries to follow this advice on a daily basis. Even triangulating among a variety of left-wing news sources on just one issue can take a couple of hours each day. You have to watch kittens, you just can't keep up with it. What's needed, in my humble opinion, is broad social support for institutions and social structures that enables concerned citizens to form good background theories. This brings me to the political problem. Remember the epistemological problem? Defining the truth is hard? That's also the political problem. It takes time. It takes a lot of time. As I said earlier, I occupy a position of extreme privilege in this regard. As Joshua Cohen and Joel Rogers, a political philosopher and a political scientist, point out in their 1983 book on democracy, which I recommend, it's still timely. Because of the time and effort demands made by most jobs in the United States, not to mention the challenges of navigating insurance and social service bureaucracies facing those who are unemployed, disabled, or giving care to others. For all these reasons, time for reading and thinking is in especially short supply for anyone outside the educated elite. To finish the picture, educational opportunity, the kinds of experiences that give people the knowledge and cognitive skills to educate themselves about complex issues and to discuss them intelligently, support for these sorts of for educational opportunities declining rapidly and overwhelmingly. But then too, we must factor in the consideration that becoming an informed citizen is less and less valuable to people at or below median incomes. Politics, especially at the national level, has become largely irrelevant to the real life issues that face large numbers of people in our society. People are cynical about politicians, and with good reason. Senatorial and presidential campaigns have turned into reality show competitions, with candidates who smoke substance-free banalities, disciplined only by market research about which particular wording best sells. The real platforms and promises are the ones candidates negotiate in camera in consultation with their donors. Polling suggests that most people are aware of and unhappy about the role that big money plays in our political system. The resulting cynicism, I suggest, makes it all too easy for voters to make their decisions on the basis of nebulous criteria like leadership or strength. And of course, most eligible voters don't vote at all. The vapidity of most campaigns also helps explain the appeal of Donald Trump, who is perceived as someone who spoke plainly and sincerely, and that made him look very different from mainstream candidates whose every word has been focused and tested. I also want to just bring up something. I don't have anything to read on this, but I do want to say something about trust. This was something that occurred to me earlier in the day. There are people who have been the victims of official doctrines, like eugenics doctrines, scientific research like the Tuskegee experiment, or neglect by government authorities and scientists like the victims of poison water in Flint, Michigan. And these people, I think, have a different basis, a different baseline for trust. It's rational for them to distrust the government, to distrust experts and scientific authorities, because they've been materially and seriously harmed by these things. So it's one thing for me to be to sniff at the objectivity of some reporter, but for people whose experience has been their concerns are ignored or trampled over, it's a real rational conclusion, I think. My background theory explains the degradation of political discourse in terms of a conspiracy theory. I believe that the United States government currently serves the interests of an economic elite. The Republicans a very narrow one, and the Democrats a somewhat broader one. Now, I'm a member of the second elite as an academic with a tenured position. I in effect, have traded off the income that some of my classmates who become lawyers or doctors may be earning for the autonomy and pleasure of making a life living doing something that I love. But in the cushy situation that I've landed has in itself become less and less available to scholars, most of whom now are non-tenure track lecturers with terrible pay, crushing teaching loads, and little to no job security. So the proletarianization of positions in the middle class, I think, is certainly a factor that we have to keep in mind in thinking about why people don't educate themselves about politics. Against this background theory, Democrats and Republicans alike have interests in obscuring the political goals they actually have. So Republicans claim to be helping the little guy by getting government off your back, and Democrats promise to foster economic prosperity by increasing social justice. But in fact, Democrats, most of them, are just as beholden to big money as the Republicans are. It's just different big money. Democrats answer to the pharmaceutical industry and the health insurance industry and the financial sector, which is a big reason why we've never seen a proposal for single-payer universal health care from a mainstream Democrat. And Bernie Sanders, of course, is not a mainstream Democrat. According to the New York Times yesterday, the mainstream is coursing increasingly to the left. That's a quote. So, you know, maybe there's hope there. That's two hopeful things. So, I share a background assumption with many Trump voters. We both think the government is out to get us. We just think that's for different reasons. I think the government has been hijacked by the ultra-wealthy. The Trump voters think it has been hijacked by people like me. In any case, my main point is that it's difficult for any individual to make any material difference with respect to large issues that affect his or her life. Members of the 1% have the financial resources to hire managers and lobbyists and to write legislation. Increasingly, the legislation that our representatives in Congress consider has been written by the lobbyists. They have the lawyers, too, to watch over and work for their interests. Members of the next next 5% can have the energy, leisure, education, and connections to join and work with direct action groups. So I work with Citizens Climate Lobby, Jewish Voice for Peace, which I mentioned, the ACLU, Black Lives Matter. These are some of the organizations to which I contribute ton of money. These organizations and others like them magnify the effects of individual effort, making large-scale change at least conceivable. But again, it's very time-consuming. You have to give up a lot of television shows if that's the trade-off, not to mention if you're working two minimum-wage jobs and have young children to take care of. There are some opportunities for collective action for people in the 95%. Religious institutions are one example, and indeed a great deal of social justice and anti-war work is accomplished through churches, synagogues, and mosques. But one important organ of collective action, labor unions, is in deep decline. Even the unions that have persisted in the face of economic reorganization and anti-labor laws, notably public service, public sector, and service unions, so teachers and nurses, are facing a moral challenge in the form of a court case that's coming up in this session, Janus versus AFSCME, which will soon be heard by a Republican majority Supreme Court, who are almost certainly going to rule against the agency fee charged by unions to bargain unit members who do not join the union but benefit from this collective bargaining. So if you don't know about this, unions, if a union is established in a workplace, they represent all the workers, even if the workers don't join the union. But in the past, unions have been able to charge a fee that covers just the cost of doing the collective bargaining and not any of the political advocacy. And that's about to go away. Unions are one way to address the high cost, low payoff reality of knowledge gathering in the United States today. In their role as custodians of their members' interests, they can perform some of the informational watchdogging needed to track the likely effects of employer and government actions. They can also increase the likely payoff of being well informed because, as collectives, they have the resources to fight for real benefits for their members. In a fantastic talk that was given impromptu at the Eastern APA meeting, the American Philosophical Association Eastern Division had its annual meeting in Savannah, Georgia, just at the time that there was an ice storm that completely paralyzed the city. So many of the people who were scheduled to be on the program weren't there. And Ken Taylor just stepped into one of these slots and gave this amazing talk. He made the point that I've been making very vividly, describing how he used to have arguments with his father over immigration policy. And Ken credited his father's union participation for giving him a man, who Ken described as having an eighth grade education, a sophisticated understanding of the economy. Unions can address the high cost of the problem of finding the truth. Unions collectively reduce the costs of finding pertinent information and also increase the payoff for working people. because they have the resources to fight for real benefits. Unions can give workers agency through collective bargaining and, if need be, through labor actions. I say all this recognizing that this is an idealized picture of union activity, but it is still the case that the period of greatest economic equality in the United States, as well as the period of greatest economic growth, was at a time when about a third of American workers were unionized. Now, nationwide, it's less than 10% workers, 10% of American workers who are unionized. Fun fact, Massachusetts has the highest rate of unionization among teachers in the United States, and also the best schools as measured by standardized tests. Not that I want to endorse that as a measure of education excellence, but just for the record, what you're interested in is standardized tests. Ours are best. The demise of unions and the rise of the gig economy has resulted in the atomization of knowledge for a large segment of the U.S. population and has greatly reduced the power of workers to change their circumstances. This is part of what Ken Taylor, again in his talk, called the infantilization of Americans, the reduction of citizens to helpless, ignorant children. Let me sum up. The problem of uninformed or misinformed citizenry does not, in my view, reflect either a disregard for the truth or a general decline in intelligence. It reflects the fact that too few of us in this country enjoy what philosopher John Rawls called the fair value of liberty. Too few of us have the resources and time to learn what the truth is, and too few of us can make any material use of the information once we have it. To support the truth, I contend, we need to support those institutions that make knowledge available and useful for everyone. I've spoken already about unions. Let me finish by talking about the institutions that support intelligence and erudition, beginning with public education. State support for public higher education has declined precipitously over the last few decades, forcing state universities to charge higher and higher tuition, to strike more and more deals with corporate America, and to pander to student customers with educationally worthless high-end amenities like glitzy food courts. UMass was just rated number one by the Princeton Review for dining halls. And they have t-shirts for sale in the student store celebrating this. There are also, at the University of Missouri, I was shown an artificial float river that the students can get tubes and drift through campus in the warm days of September. That's one thing at the higher education level. At the K-12 level, the movement for what's called, misleadingly, school choice, where it has not been beaten back by concerned citizens, many of whom are members of union. In Massachusetts, we did beat back one of these challenges, despite being outspent by a factor of about 500. The movement for so-called school choice is decimating public K-12 schools. If we cannot offer all citizens quality education, ideological fake news will rush in to fill the gap. But education is not enough. We have to ensure that knowledge is valuable, that everyone can put their knowledge to good use. To that end, we must ensure that all citizens have access to collective action so that they may join their individual efforts with those of others to make genuine improvements in their own lives. So if we want the truth, I think we need justice.